Good afternoon, children. Welcome to the webinar number 3 of Zoology lecture series designed for intermediate students of Telangana. This is first year special classes, and I am Vishnu Priya Pitani, principal, TSMS Palamakula, and I will be chairing this session today. Today's lecture is taught by Mr. Kranti Kumar of TSMS Karivirala. The topic for today's session is biodiversity. You may recall that the previous two lectures were on the basics of diversity in the living world. The topics that were covered included the nature and scope of zoology, branches of zoology, and classification. You now know that there is a variety of living organisms, including plants, animals, fungi, and microorganisms. All these organisms are interconnected like a web and form the biodiversity of the planet. Today, Mr. Kranti Kumar will discuss what exactly biodiversity is, why it is important, and what we can do to preserve it. The topic is very significant in this day and age, especially as human activities have impacted the natural environment around us. According to the UN report, alarmingly, 10 lakh plant and animal species are threatened with extinction in the upcoming decades, the highest ever in human history. Therefore, I would like all of you to pay close attention to this topic and learn well about biodiversity. Now, without further ado, over to Kranti sir. Sir, you may take over.
Yes. Thank you, ma'am.
You're welcome.
Good afternoon, students. We have completed two lessons. And today, I am going to tell third lesson, that is diversity of a living world. Now I am sharing my screen. So, part 3, in the diversity of living world. In this topic, we'll discuss biodiversity. So, in biodiversity, several subtopics are there, like levels of biodiversity, species and area relationship, threats to biodiversity, and conservation of biodiversity. Okay, we will discuss these topics in today's lesson. Before going to lesson, I will ask few questions. What is diversity? Students, what is diversity? It is the state of being variant or different. It means understanding that each individual is unique. That is diversity. So, different one in the state that we call diversity. What is meant by biodiversity? You can see here butterflies. These all are butterflies, but they are different from one to another. The term biodiversity from biological diversity refers to the variety of life on the earth. So, why is biodiversity important? Why we have to learn the biodiversity? Biodiversity boosts ecosystem productivity, where each species, no matter how small, all have an important role to play. Each species in an ecosystem has a specific niche, that is a specific role to play. So that's why biodiversity is very important. So let's go into our lesson, biodiversity. You can see here different animals. These animals are different from one to another. So here we'll talk about biodiversity. variation of life at various levels of biological organization. Variation of life at various levels of biological organization, that we call biodiversity. The concept of biodiversity was introduced by Norman Mayer. Edward Wilson, he popularized the term biodiversity. Norman Mayer, he introduced the concept of biodiversity, and Edward Wilson, he popularized the term biodiversity. So let's talk about levels of biodiversity. Three levels are there in biodiversity. One is genetic diversity, species diversity, and ecological diversity. These are the three levels of biodiversity. We'll discuss one by one. First, genetic diversity. What is genetic diversity? Genetic diversity means diversity at the gene level. If you take a species, species means, you know already, a group of similar organisms. A group of organisms, same kind or same appearance. So here in that group, the organism, one organism is different from another one. Why it is different from one to another? Here, based on their genetic material. Genetic material means nothing but genes. Here, diversity at a gene level, that we call genetic diversity. I will give some example here. You can see this plant. This plant is a Rauwolfia vomitoria. This plant producing the alkaloid reserpine. Reserpine is an alkaloid. It is used for high blood pressure, that is a hypertension. Okay. If you take a group of Rauwolfia plants, in that the producing reserpine alkaloid concentration and potency is varying from one plant to another one. So this is genetic variation. Mm-hmm. You may see in the Rauwolfia vomitoria. All are same plants, Rauwolfia vomitoria plants only, but the producing alkaloid potency and concentration is different from one plant to another plant. That we call genetic variation or genetic diversity. And you can see another examples like rice, Oryza sativa. You know already, in India, more than 50,000 rice strains are there. And you can see mangoes. Thousands of varieties of mangoes are there. So these we call genetic diversity. They belongs to same species, but variation is there. That we call genetic diversity. Genetic diversity, it increases with environmental variability. So based on the environment, genetic diversity is there. So it is increasing with respect to environment. Next one, species diversity. Diversity at species level. If you take two regions, I will give one example. Amphibian diversity in the Western Ghats is greater than that of Eastern Ghats. If you compare two regions, Western Ghats and Eastern Ghats, the diversity of organisms is different. In Western Ghats, more diversity is there when compared to the Eastern Ghats. Here, more number of species are there in Western Ghats. Less number of species are there in Eastern Ghats. This is a species diversity. Diversity at species level, we call species diversity. And next one, ecological diversity. Ecological diversity means diversity at the ecosystem level. Diversity at the ecosystem level. So three indices of ecological diversity. One is alpha diversity, beta diversity, and gamma diversity. So these are the three indices are there in ecological diversity. We'll discuss one by one. First one, alpha diversity. What is alpha diversity? You can see here, this is a one ecosystem, that is a lake ecosystem. In this lake ecosystem, number of organisms are there, like a number of species are there. Whatever the organisms, number of species are there. So here, how to explain the alpha diversity? So we can measure the counting the number of species or number of taxa in that particular area or ecosystem, that it tells the alpha diversity. So the number of species which are present in that particular ecosystem, that will explain the alpha diversity. That is the alpha diversity. So for example, if you take in this lake ecosystem, it has a 100 species. So that is the alpha diversity. Okay. And next one, beta diversity. So what is beta diversity? Here we are comparing between two ecosystems. So the species diversity between two adjacent ecosystems. So if you take this is one ecosystem and this is one ecosystem. We are comparing number of species or number of taxa unit to each of the ecosystem. Unit to each of the ecosystem. Here, a number of taxa are 100. If you take an ecosystem one having 100 number of species and ecosystem two having 60 number of species. If you compare these two, how many number of taxa are unique? So that is the beta diversity. That is the beta diversity. And third one, gamma diversity. In the measure of the overall diversity for different ecosystems within an ecological region. You can see here, four ecosystems are there. Ecosystem 1, 2, 3, 4. So here we are comparing among the ecosystem. Okay. These ecosystems are present in one ecological area. You can see the violet color area. This is ecological region. In this ecological region, four ecosystems are there. Four ecosystems are there. Okay. So here we are comparing among the ecosystem. In one ecosystem, 10 number of species are there. In another ecosystem, 50 and 60. So like that, if you compare among the ecosystems, how many number of tags are unique? That is the gamma diversity. Okay. Endemic species. What is endemic species? A species unit to a given area. For example, you take one area. So a species which is only related to particular area, that species we call endemic species. The species only available in that particular area. So that kind of species we call endemic species. Let's talk about a pattern of diversity. Pattern of diversity, it depends on two factors. One is a latitude, another one is species area relationship. So first we'll discuss latitude. Latitudinal gradient in diversity. You can see here picture globe. The horizontal lines on the globe we call latitudes. Here, latitudinal gradient in diversity means based on the latitudes, diversity is there. Biodiversity shows uneven distribution. It is not a uniform manner. It's an uneven distribution. The diversity increases from poles to the equator. So this is the North Pole and this is the South Pole. North Pole to equator and South Pole to equator, diversity is increasing. Okay. So the middle one is 0 degrees. This we call equator. The above 90 degrees we call North Pole and the below one is the South Pole. So if you move from polar region to equator, diversity is increasing. This we can see in latitudinal gradient. You can see here, tropical region. Tropical region is favorable for living of more species. What is tropical region? You can see here, one line is there that we call Tropic of Cancer. And you can see here, Tropic of Capricorn. In between the Tropic of Cancer and Tropic of Capricorn, that region we call tropical region. So in this tropical region, sunlight availability is more. That's why it is a favorable for living of more species. And you can see one table. Here, based on the latitudes, how the diversity is there, we can understand clearly. Place, Colombia. The Colombia place is at a 0 degrees latitude. In this region, number of types of birds are 1400. And New York, it is at 41 degrees to the north side, North Pole towards the North Pole. And in this New York region, number of types of birds are 105. And then take Greenland, it is at 71 degrees to the North Pole. In this region, number of types of birds are 56. Here, what we can understand from this tabular form, it is a lower latitudes have more species when compared to the higher latitudes. If you see here, 0 to 71, the number of types of birds are decreasing. Okay. Lower latitudes have more species when compared to the higher latitudes. That we can understand from this table. Then, what are the reasons for greater biodiversity in tropics? Different reasons are there. We'll discuss one by one. First one is tropical latitudes have been undisturbed for millions of years. There is no disturbance in the tropical latitudes for millions of years. And another one, tropical climates are relatively more constant than temperate regions. So climatic conditions are constant in tropical area when compared to the temperate regions. Climate conditions means mostly temperature, pressure, rainfall, humidity. So these all are comes under climate conditions. So these are constant in tropical areas when compared to the temperate regions. That's why more diversity is there in tropical area. Then another one is solar energy and water availability are available in abundance. So more solar energy and water availability is there. That's why greater diversity is there in tropical area. Next one, next factor, that is the species area relationship. Before going to species area relationship, we have to know species richness. What is species richness? Species richness means number of species per unit area. Number of species per unit area. If you take an area, in that place, how many number of species are there? that is species richness. In a particular area, how many number of species are there? That is the species richness. Okay, so more number of species are there, that is more number of species richness. If more number of species are present in that particular area, more is the species richness. If less number of species are there, that is the less in species richness. Then Alexander Van Humboldt, he experimented on species richness. What he observed, species richness increased with increasing explored area, but only up to a limit. Increasing species richness with increasing explored area, but it is only up to a limit. It is not always. And you can see a graph plotted in between species richness and area. Species richness we take on y-axis and area on x-axis. We will get one non-linear curve. Okay, so this non-linear curve, it gives one equation, that is S is equal to C into A power Z. This equation is tell about relation between species richness and area. Okay, here S is equal to species richness, A is equal to area, and C is equal to y-axis intercept, and Z is the slope of the line. Species richness, area, and C is the y-axis intercept, Z is the slope of the line. So to understand betterly, we are giving logarithmic values to this equation, S is equal to C into A power Z. So we will get the log S is equal to log C plus Z log A. This is the linear line. This is the linear equation. Here, based on the Z value, species richness will be there. What we can understand from this graph means, based on the Z value, species richness will be there. So Z value is a one in this equation, that is a log S is equal to log C plus Z log A. So here slope is the 45 degrees centigrade, 45 degrees. So in the 45 degrees slope, Z value is one. If Z value is more, where the Z value is more, Z value is more at a tropical regions, like a tropical rainforest. In that particular region, Z value is more than one. Where the diversity is less, in that particular region, Z value is less than one. Okay, so by this equation, we can understand the species area relationship. Okay. And next, hypothesis. You can see here scientist Paul Ehrlich, he imagined like aeroplane as ecosystem and rivet as species. You can see here, what is rivet? Rivet means bolt-like structure. This bolt-like structure, it joins the parts of the aeroplane that we call rivet. These rivets we are using for joining the parts of the aeroplane. So here rivet is a like species, aeroplane is like ecosystem. Okay. If you remove the critical species, may affect the entire ecosystem. How it compared? For example, if any rivet is removed from the aeroplane, it in minor affected area, like if you remove the rivet at seat region, that will not affect the aeroplane. But if you remove the rivet at particular region, like where the wings are attached to the aeroplane body, that will affect the aeroplane. It may damage the aeroplane. Okay, like that, removal of critical species also affects the entire ecosystem. That is a critical species. That species have a specific role in that ecosystem. If you remove that species, it will affect the entire ecosystem. So that is the hypothesis we can see here. That is the rivet popper hypothesis that was proposed by Paul Ehrlich. Role of biodiversity. So role of biodiversity on human life, how the biodiversity is having a role on human life. Biodiversity is beneficial to human beings. So how we can explain the role of biodiversity on human life? We can explain in three aspects. One is a narrowly utilitarian argument and broadly utilitarian argument, ethical argument. We'll discuss one by one. First one is narrowly utilitarian argument. Human beings derive constantly economic benefits from nature, as biodiversity is a reservoir of resources. Many resources are there in biodiversity. We'll get many products like food, fiber, medicines, everything from nature. So that's, we can say, like a narrowly utilitarian argument. Some compounds, medicinal products like bean blastin, it's a anti-cancer drug, we can get from Vinca rosea plant. And digitalin, it is also one medicinal product we'll get from Digitalis purpurea plant. This digitalin used in cardiac to treat cardiac problems. Here, and some other industrial products are also there, like tannins, rubber, dyes, resins, perfumes, etc. Many more products are we are getting from the nature or biodiversity. So this is the narrowly utilitarian argument. And next one, broadly utilitarian argument. We cannot put a price tag. Biodiversity or nature is giving more products. We cannot put a price tag to each and everything. We cannot purchase. We cannot buy those products. That is impossible. Okay. Here, one example I am giving. One is Amazon rainforest. They are producing 20% of total oxygen in the Earth atmosphere. If there is no Amazon forest, we will not get the sufficient amount of oxygen. And another one is pollination by pollinating agents. Several pollinating agents are there, like bees, birds, bats, etc. These pollinating agents are involving in pollination process. Without pollination, there is no plants and there is no fruits, seeds, etc. Okay, so we cannot put a price tag to each and everything in the biodiversity. That is the broadly utilitarian argument. And there are other benefits also which cannot be measured in terms of money, like aesthetic pleasure. If you see any kind of nature, we will feel some pleasure that we cannot measure in terms of money. That is the broadly utilitarian argument. And next one, ethical argument. plants, animals, and microbes, species with which we coexist on this planet. So here, one is having relation with another one. We are depending one on another. Every one of these species have an intrinsic value. This is a ethical argument. And next one, threats to biodiversity. Let's talk about threats to biodiversity. This is a very important one nowadays. Four major causes for species extinction in the world. These four major causes we call the evil quartet. The evil quartet. Quartet means four. So these are the four major causes. What are the four major causes? Habitat loss and fragmentation, overexploitation, invasion of alien species, and co-extinction. We'll discuss one by one. First one is habitat loss and fragmentation. So here you can see deforestation. What is happening due to deforestation? Deforestation leads to species extinction in the forest. If there is no forest, there is no animals. If there is no plant, there is no animals. Tropical forests are reduced from 14% to 4% on the earth. So 14% to 4% reduction takes place means several species are become extinct. And next one, see, conversion of forest land to agriculture land. In Amazon rainforest, cutting and clearing to cultivate for the soya beans. For the cultivation of soya beans, they are converting forest land to agriculture land. So this is also major effect for the biodiversity. And you see pollution. Pollution enhances the degradation of habitats. Due to the pollution, habitat loss takes place. Animals cannot survive in that particular area due to pollution. So that is also leads to the habitat loss. And fragmentation of habitat leads to population decline. So how the fragmentation of habitat leads to population decline? The fragmentation, what is fragmentation? Fragmentation means the process of formation of discontinuous in the natural habitats. Discontinuous in the natural habitats. For example, this fragmentation takes place by two processes. One is a geological process, another one is human activity. If the fragmentation happened by the geological fragmentation, that leads to speciation. If you take one area, it is fragmented, it is divided like two areas. That leads to speciation. But the fragmentation caused by man, that leads to extinction. So this is the habitat loss and fragmentation. And next one is over-exploitation. When need turns to greed, it leads to over-exploitation. Need means what we require. Greed means what we not require. That is a If when the need turns to greed, that leads to the over-exploitation. You can see two pictures here. One is a stellar sea cow, another one is passenger pigeon. You can see these animals as pictures only. Why? These animals are extincted due to over exploitation by humans, by hunting or fishing. By this purpose, over exploitation is a very great threat to biodiversity. Next one, invasion of alien species. What is the alien species? Alien species means a new one to that particular habitat that we call alien species. When alien species are introduced into a habitat, they turn invasive and dominate the local species. So the newer one will dominate on the already present one that we call invasion of alien species. I will give one example here. You can see the Nile perch and a cichlid fish. So cichlid fishes, 300 species of cichlid fishes are extincted due to Nile perch. What happened? Nile perch introduced into Lake Victoria in East Africa. It led to extinction of 300 species of cichlid fishes in that lake. So these are the beautiful cichlid fishes are already extincted due to the invasion of alien species. Okay. And co-extinction. You can see plant and pollinator mutualism. Here, an obligate association between plant and animal. Here, if a plant becomes extinct, the animal also becomes extinct. That is the association is there. If there is no plants, there is no animals. This is called co-extinction. So, how do we conserve biodiversity? We already discussed threats of biodiversity. So we know several threats are there. How do we conserve the biodiversity? Two main types of conservation methods are there. One is a in situ conservation, ex situ conservation. In situ conservation means on site conservation. Ex situ conservation means off-site conservation. On-site means where the living organisms are living in that particular habitat only we are conserving. That is the in-situ conservation. Okay. In this in-situ conservation, various methods are there like national parks, sanctuaries, biosphere reserves, sacred groves. By this ways, we will conserve the biodiversity like in-situ conservation. Here, in-situ conservation is an ideal conservation strategy. And we can see another one, ex-situ conservation. This ex-situ conservation is a backup solution to in-situ conservation. If in-situ conservation failed, we can use the ex-situ conservation. We'll get the species from the ex-situ conservation. That is the off-site conservation. So this is the backup process for the in-situ conservation, that is the ex-situ conservation. In ex-situ conservation, different things are there. One is zooparks, cryopreservation, in vitro culture, and gene banks. So these conservation strategies we can see here, like in-situ and ex-situ. We'll discuss one by one. First one, in-situ conservation. In-situ conservation means it's a process of protecting an animal species in its natural habitat. So where the animal is living, in that particular habitat only we are conserving. That we call in-situ conservation. So for the in-situ conservation, we can use national parks, sanctuaries, biosphere reserves, sacred groves. Biodiversity hotspot. What is biodiversity hotspot? You can see picture here where the colored regions are there. Those colored regions are biodiversity hotspots. What is biodiversity hotspot? It is a biogeographic region with a significant reservoir of biodiversity. In that particular area, biodiversity is more. So that's why that is under threat of extinction from human. So that the area is having more biodiversity, that is under threat. There are 35 hotspots in the world. You can see in the map, 35 hotspots are there. These are the colored regions you can see in the world map. Those are the biodiversity hotspots. Norman Mayers. Norman Mayers, he proposed the concept of biodiversity hotspot. So I already told 35 hotspots in the world. So some examples I am giving here, which are in the India and also near to the India. One is the Western Ghats and Sri Lanka. You can see here. Western Ghats and Sri Lanka. It is also one biodiversity hotspot. And another one is Indo-Burma region and Himalayas. So these are the three hotspots near to the India. In India, biodiversity rich regions are legally protected as biosphere reserves, national parks, and sanctuaries. 18 biosphere reserves are there, 90 national parks are there, and 448 sanctuaries are there. Biosphere reserve. What is biosphere reserve? An area which is set aside, minimally disturbed for the conservation of the resources of the biosphere. So for the conservation purpose, an area which is aside and minimally disturbed, that area we call biosphere reserve. 18 biosphere reserves are there in India. 17th one is Seshachalam Hills, and the latest one, 18th, is Panna, it is in Madhya Pradesh. National parks. It is a natural habitat strictly reserved for the protection of natural life. So here, some strict rules are there for the protection of natural life, means animals protection. You can see national parks, Jim Corbett National Park, it is in Uttarakhand, Kaziranga National Park in Assam, Kasu Brahmananda Reddy National Park, it is in Hyderabad, Telangana. Mahavir Harina Vanasthali, it is also a national park. It is also located in Hyderabad in Telangana. Kiladiyo Gana National Park, it is in Rajasthan. These are a few examples for national parks. Next one, sanctuaries. What is sanctuary? Sanctuary is for a specific endangered faunal species. In this sanctuary, what we will do, a specific endangered faunal species are well protected in wildlife sanctuaries, which permits ecotourism. Okay. So here some examples are there for sanctuaries like Koringa Sanctuary, Eduru Nagaram Sanctuary, Papikondalu Sanctuary These are the sanctuaries are there. Nearly 400 above sanctuaries are there in India. So each sanctuary, it is a specific for endangered faunal species. You can see sacral grooves. What is groove? Groove means a group of trees. A group of trees of a special religious importance to a particular culture that we call sacred group. Here, religious importance is there to that particular group of trees. In this sacred group, they are the people who are living in that particular area, they are venerated. They will worship the nature and they will give protection to sacred groves. And we can see some examples for sacred groves. Kasi and Janita Hills, Meghalaya, and Aravali Hills. These are located in between Rajasthan and Gujarat. Western Ghats region, it is in between Karnataka and Maharashtra. And Sarguja Bastar, it is at Chhattisgarh. Chanda, it is in Madhya Pradesh. These are the few examples for sacred groves. And next one, ex situ conservation. We have discussed in situ conservation already. Will conserve the nature or biodiversity by the institute conservation with the national parks, biosphere reserves, sacred groves, sanctuaries. And another type of conservation is extensive conservation. Threatened animals are taken out of their natural habitat and placed in a special settings where they are protected. So in the institute conservation, we already saw animals are living in that particular natural habitat only. But in extensive conservation, we are taken out from their natural habitat and we are placing in a special settings. One example is zoo parks. In the zoo parks, we can see the animals. So we are keeping those animals in a special settings. By the way, we are protecting animals. That is a conservation method. And another one is a cryopreservation. So here, how do we preserve the biodiversity? We are preserving the gametes and embryos of the threatened species. We are preserving the gametes and embryos of the threatened species at a minus 196 degrees centigrade. Why we are preserving at a minus 196 degrees centigrade? This is liquid nitrogen temperature. So at the liquid nitrogen temperature, there is no damage to the genetic material. That's why we are preserving gametes and embryos of threatened species. This is one type of a backup solution. And in vitro culture and gene banks for plants. So here we are talking about plants are also. You can see tissue culture or in vitro culture. Plants are growing in the glassware or bottle. And you can see here some trays. In this tray, seeds are there. We are conserving or we are protecting the plant species, threatened plant species. Which plants are under the threat? So that plants we are preserving or we are conserving by the way of in vitro culture and gene banks. IUCN Red Data Book. You can see Red Data Book. What is IUCN? IUCN means International Union for the Conservation of Nature and Natural Resources. This IUCN is a world's main authority on the issues of conservation status of species. IUCN Red Data Book, it explains the conservation status of species. IUCN, it publishes the Red Data Book. In this book, all the threatened species are listed. All the threatened species are enlisted in the Red Data Book, published by IUCN. So, in IUCN Red Data Book, animal species are classified into different categories based on degree of risk. You can see different color pattern here. Here, the black and violet are already extincted. You can see these are the three regions. These are threatened regions. One is a critically endangered, this is a red color one. And next one is a endangered and vulnerable. Critically endangered means extremely high risk. These are the animals which are critically endangered are extremely high risk. These animals will become extinct in very near future. It is critically endangered. And what about endangered? Very few animals are there. These are also under risk. And another one is vulnerable. These vulnerable means are likely to become endangered. These are likely to become endangered. So, critically endangered, endangered, and vulnerable. These three are threatened category. Next one. Conservation of wildlife in India. How to conserve of wildlife in India? We can conserve wildlife by three ways. That is legislation, preservation, and organization protection. First one is legislation. Legislation means under the provision of Wildlife Act 1972, Government of India is imposing some punishments. Here, government involvement is there in the legislation. Killing endangered species is strictly prohibited, and selling of wildlife products is a punishable offense. Okay, this is about the legislation. We are imposing the severe punishments for the conservation of wildlife. And next one is preservation. Natural parks, sanctuaries, biosphere reserves, sacred groves, the different regions which can protect diverse fauna and flora. We already discussed these things in Institute of Conservation. And third one is organizational protection. Several, mainly two organizations are there. They are working very hard for the conservation of wildlife. One is the Wildlife Protection Society of India, which is located in Dehradun. And another one is the Geological Society of India, which is in Kolkata. Here, The conservation of wildlife is not only the country responsibility, it is a global responsibility. Like some conferences like Earth Summit and World Summits are also happening or held. Earth Summit, you can see here, it held in 1992 in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. And World Summit 2002, it's held in Johannesburg in South Africa. With these summits, the responsible persons from countries, they will meet and they will discuss on various conservation process and strategies, how to conserve the wildlife, they will discuss. And they will also sign on some agreements, conservation strategies or conservation approaches. Based on that, the governments will follow. So this is about conservation of wildlife. So the main importance of this lesson is conservation of wildlife. Conservation is very important nowadays. Next, we can see some threatened species in India. One is the Asiatic lion, that is a Panthera leo persica. Scientific name is Panthera leo persica. This species is under threat. And blue buck, that is antelope cervicapra, red panda, Ailurus ocracius, and a lion-tailed macaque, that is a Macaca silunus, Panthera tigris, that is a tiger, Kashmiri stag, Cervus elaphus hunglu, elephant, this is a Elephas maximus indicus, Indian elephant, pygmy hawk, that is Suchus salvinius, Siberian crane, Grus leucogranus, and slender loris, that is Loris tardigradus. So these are the threatened species in India. So by this lesson, we have learnt different topics like biodiversity, levels of biodiversity, species area relationship, threats to biodiversity, conservation of biodiversity. I hope you have learned a lot of information from this lesson. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for the elaborate and comprehensive discussion on biodiversity. I'm pretty sure students might have understood a lot about biodiversity and its preservation. So with this, the first chapter is concluded. So I request all the students to read the textbook chapter thoroughly and gather more information about biodiversity hotspots and watch the video many times. And thank you, Kranti sir, for this presentation. And thanks to all the students for participating in this webinar. I would like to express my gratitude to our additional director, sir, for providing this platform to overcome the adversity in teaching and learning imposed in this pandemic situation. Students can subscribe to this Model School channel to get more updates and stay tuned. Thank you, sir.